This is one of four ways to get water into your steam train. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. I'm here at Greenfield Village in Dearborn, Michigan today, and this is their water tower, which provides water to all three of their steam locomotives. But not all of it here. Actually, they have two different methods of providing water, and let's take a look at both of them today. So this tower was built in 1993 to replace an older tower. That tower was found to be unrepairable, unfortunately. It was actually supplied in kit form from Rosenwalk Tank Company in Long Island City, New York. These tanks, if you've ever seen the tops of New York City buildings, are pretty common. About the only thing that's different is over here on the left-hand side, the spout for filling up the steam locomotive's tender. This one has a 39,000 gallon capacity. And if you look at the gauge here on the side, you'll see zeros at the top, all the way down to 39 at the bottom of the gauge. If you get past that 39, it starts overflowing the top. That, of course, is connected to a simple rope to a cable, to a float on the inside. As that float goes up, the gauge goes down, so you can tell how much water is in there. Looks like we're about 34, 35,000 gallons today. That should be enough for today's operations. This is actually on the small side for tanks. Typical steam train water towers tended to run about 50 to more than 200,000 gallons. And you needed that capacity because your trains actually used that. So we look up here at the spout, see you have about a 6-inch diameter pipe coming out into the much larger diameter spout, and then the flexible canvas that actually goes into the tender. Again, this is kind of on the small side. Normally you'd have about an 8 to 12 inch pipe here, and that could deliver as much as 2,600 gallons per minute. You needed that because your typical locomotive would actually hold around 8,000 gallons in the tender, and some, of course, would hold far more than that.
It looks like the Edison isn't stopping for water here right now, and there's a good reason for that. Let's go up to the main station to see why. As we walk across the yard, note the large water column. This is the second common way to get water to your steam train, and it is actually one of two which are located here in the village. They're connected via an underground pipe to the water tower we were just looking at. It still works the same way as the water tower, just at a greater distance. Let's go watch one in action. We're now at the main Greenfield Village station, right at the entrance. The steam train is often the first thing people here see as they walk into the gate. You also see that they put the water column right at the station. This wasn't a coincidence. Stopping for water didn't usually take too long, but you did still have to stop. Ideally, if you stopped for a station to pick up or drop off passengers or cargo, or at a switchyard, you always want to top up your tender. This saves you from making an additional stop later on, making operations more efficient. That liquid he's dumping in is to help prevent corrosion through the system, as well as helping to prevent mineral buildup. They used to say, don't put it in your boiler if you wouldn't drink it, but using these additives can help extend the life of boilers and other parts. You see how easy it is, or at least how easy it looks, to fill up. You just pull down the spout, fill up the tank, then push it back up when you're done. It takes a little time to fill up, and, well, it doesn't always go quite this smoothly. Here's what happened the last time around. There is some play in the system, so you don't need to be exact where you stop the train. But you do have to be pretty close. The engineer could have backed up a bit, just to make sure it lined up. But instead, he just went around again and came back a half hour later to fill up. While the Edison gets back to work, let's look at the third way to get water into your steam train. This is really more of a new way to get water into your steam train, but as water towers vanished, more and more locomotives were fitted with fire hose connections. This allows you to get good, high-volume water when running historic locomotives on modern lines without water towers. Of course, if you don't have a fire hydrant handy at the station, you can use the same system with a pump to get water from a tanker truck instead. Some locomotives have actually had these connections for a long time, and they were fitted with steam-powered pumps, which would allow them to stop over a river or next to a pond and just pump their own water straight into the tender. I've heard this wasn't especially common, though. If you know any that did this, please let me know in the comments. The fourth way to get water into your steam train is just a bit more exciting since you don't actually stop. This film of the Empire State Express was shot in 1905 by Thomas Edison and shows the use of track pans or water troughs for picking up water. Track pans work by placing a long, flat trough between the rails. These troughs, typically about a third of a mile long or more, were filled with water. The designs could vary somewhat, but at the Great Western Railway in England, for example, they were 1 foot 5 inch wide and held water 5 inches deep. This removed segment is bent out a little bit at the left, but as you can see, these are pretty simple. A A water scoop was installed on the bottom of the tender, carried in the raised position normally. As he reached the track pan, the crew would lower the scoop, as you can see here, from a lucky photographer who caught it just before it went into the water. In the tender, things are really simple, as we can see from this 1862 design. From the scoop, it's just a pipe up through the center of the tender to the top, then deflect it to fill the tender. The top of the tender had large vents, both to allow air to blow out while filling, but also to allow the excess water to flow out the top once it was full. Here, from the film La Bête Humaine, we see the actual process of deploying the water scoop from inside the cab. You see the fireman watching for the start of the track pan while the engineer prepares to deploy the scoop. Optimum speed was around 45 miles per hour, although it worked faster or slower as well. When they hit the right point, the engineer deploys the scoop and water shoots into the tender. Note the extra safety features to prevent the scoop from deploying accidentally. The fireman keeps a close eye on position and calls out for the engineer to pull up the scoop and then quickly assist in pulling it back up. If you didn't pull the scoop up fast enough, at best, you'd rip it off the bottom of the tender. At worst, you might end up derailing the train. So I really wish I could have shown you original video of a steam train using track pans, water troughs, to pick up water. They can get over 1,000 gallons of water in just 30 seconds to a minute without slowing down. It's an incredible technology, but unfortunately, as far as I can tell, no one still uses these and none of these still exist anywhere. If you do know of one, be sure to let me know down in the comments. In the meantime, we'll just watch this piece of film from 1898 as this train demonstrates why this is the Industrial Revolution. Before you go, I do need your help. There's two things you can do. Number one is help YouTube get more people to the channel. Easiest way you can do that, completely free, hit like on the video, subscribe to the channel, and best of all, you can comment more than just two or three words. That tells YouTube, you know, this video is good, the channel's good, send more people here. Second thing you can do, each of these videos ends up being pretty expensive to actually produce. Obviously, it's hours of work for each one, but I also have to actually drive to the locations. And if it's far enough away, I have to spend a night in order to do all the on-location filming that I do for these videos, that I think is essential for the videos. If you can help out financially, either with a super thanks, or if you can help out over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution, that'll help me to extend my range even further, get out to more and better sites, and bring you even better videos. Thanks for watching. Look forward to seeing you next time.